Well, good evening, everybody, and Merry Christmas. It's a great evening to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So, a couple of things that I'm just going to say. It's going to be a little different today. We're going to do a lot of singing, a lot of songs that are very familiar. And it's great, just a great night to worship. I just want to say a couple of things. First, for everyone that's visiting with us, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. It's so wonderful that you're here. For those of our church that gave up seats so that our visitors can sit, thank you, too. That's a wonderful thing. It reminds me of two things. When I was a kid, it was always standing room only going to church on Christmas, which is kind of exciting, right? But what it really reminds me, and if it's any encouragement for those in the back that are standing, I remember in 1995, me and Lori were dating, and the Indians made it to the World Series. And, you know, it was such a big deal that they run the World Series. And I desperately wanted to impress her and get tickets. So I was able to get tickets. And we got tickets in what was called the auxiliary bleachers, okay, that they set up. And they were pretty bad seats and pretty uncomfortable. And I ended up standing most of the game. But I didn't care because I was watching the Indians in the World Series. So for those of you that are standing, this is a much more significant event, worshiping our Savior, than the Indians being in the World Series. So thank you all very much. It is a great evening to be in the house of the Lord. Why don't you stand with me as we open up our worship service this evening? Brothers and sisters, let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we gather here today, as your children, as brothers and sisters in the faith, Lord, gathered in your house to celebrate your birth, Jesus, to celebrate you becoming Emmanuel, God with us. Lord, we ask you humbly that you would forgive us of our sins. Lord Jesus, be with us. Help us to turn from our sin and help us to turn toward you. Help us to follow you more closely, Lord. Help us to become more like you, Lord. And help us in understanding the incomprehensible wonder of your incarnation, the awesome grace that you have showered upon us, Lord, our duty and our desire to follow you more dearly with our lives. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would bless and be with each and every one of us, and we lift up to you the prayers of your church. Lord, we lift up to you not only those that we have been praying for, but we lift up to you the prayers that have not been spoken yet, that are within our hearts, for you know all things. And you tell us in Scripture, Lord, to cast our cares and our anxieties upon you, for you love us. Lord, we pray not only for our church, but for our community. We pray, Lord, that you give us, your church, the strength and the wisdom to fulfill the mission that you've given us, to be a light in the darkness, to be an example of what it means to be a follower of Christ and to share the name of Jesus with a world that desperately needs it. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the gifts that we receive this day, that they're given with cheerful and generous hearts, knowing that all things come from you and all things return to you. Jesus, we love you. Be with us always. We ask for this in your precious name. Amen. Ushers, if you come forward, please.
You may be seated.
Sim.
For tonight's message, we're going to be in the Gospel of Matthew. The Gospel of Matthew, we're going to read chapters 1 through chapter 2, verse 12. I believe it might be, is it going to be on the screen tonight? No. Okay. If you have your Bibles, follow along with me. We're going to be in chapter 1, starting at verse 1. A record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac, the father of Jacob. Jacob, the father of Judah and his brothers. Judah, the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. Perez, the father of Hezron. Hezron, the father of Ram. Ram, the father of Amminadab. Amminadab, the father of Nahshon. Nahshon, the father of Salmon. Salmon, the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz, the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed, the father of Jesse, and Jesse, the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife. Solomon, the father of Rehoboam. Rehoboam, the father of Abijah. Abijah, the father of Asa. Asa, the father of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat, the father of Jeroham. Jeroham, the father of Uzziah. Uzziah, the father of Jotham. Jotham, the father of Ahaz. Ahaz, the father of Hezekiah. Hezekiah, the father of Manasseh. Manasseh, the father of Amon. Amon, the father of Josiah. And Josiah, the father of Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the exile to Babylon. After the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel. Shealtiel, the father of Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel, the father of Abiab. Abiab, the father of Eliakim. Eliakim, the father of Azor. Azor, the father of Zadok. Zadok, the father of Achim. Achim, the father of Eliud. Eliud, the father of Eleazar. Eleazar, the father of Mathan. Mathan, the father of Jacob. And Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Thus there were 14 generations in all, from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile of Babylon, and 14 from the exile to the Christ. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man, he did not want to expose her to public disgrace. He had in mind to divorce her quietly, but after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. And when Joseph woke, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi came from the east to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." And when King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel." And then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go, make careful search of the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." And after they had heard the king, they went on their way. And the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down. And they worshiped him. And then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and incense and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Lord Jesus, on this evening where we celebrate your birth, Lord, fill this place with the Holy Spirit. Fill our hearts with the Holy Spirit. Lord, make them tender to the leading of your word. And fill our minds and our ears with the Holy Spirit. And make them attentive to your word, that we may love your word, that we may learn your word, and that we may live your word. And we ask for this in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. You know, it's been about 3 years, and tonight's message is Remember Who You Are, but it's been about 3 years since I've done a Christmas Eve service where I talked about the genealogy in Matthew. And I love genealogies, and I think you'll see why. It's not just because I love showing off that I can pronounce all those names. But there's really a lot of pastors are afraid to preach on genealogies, but genealogies and scriptures are incredibly important. And I think we're going to see why. So I'm going to start with a question. How many Christmas Eve services have you attended in your lifetime? Right? Probably lots, probably many. And the question that always comes up is there anything new for you to hear on this evening concerning the birth of Jesus Christ? Right? Is there anything new? As a pastor, a lot of times I wonder what I can bring to the story that's fresh or new that I can pull out of it. But brothers and sisters, here's the thing, and this is the reality of it. The birth, the incarnation of Jesus, of Emmanuel coming to live with us, is not about something fresh or about something new that needs to be brought to you. It is about the old story of Jesus Christ's birth coming afresh to us, letting the Holy Spirit bringing it to our lives and having it touch us and transform us from the inside out, bringing illumination to the scripture as we pray earnestly for the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts and fill our minds. So this evening, I want to spend a little time reflecting on Jesus's ancestors, on this genealogy recorded for us here in the first chapter of Matthew. And this is how interesting it is. The early church fathers felt that the genealogy in Matthew was so important that they placed the Gospel of Matthew first at the beginning of the New Testament, even though Mark was actually written first. They placed it first because they felt that it was so important understanding the genealogy of Jesus. So why is that? Well, think about it this way. Tracing your family tree is an interesting thing, right? And it's a popular thing. That's why you see all sorts of, you know, Ancestry.com and all these things that you can go out and check your family tree and go back in history, right? We soon realize when we start to do those kinds of things and look at our family tree that it's not just some dusty historical or academic exercise, but the people that we learn about, they come alive again sometimes before us. Sometimes we find surprising facts or even scandalous facts as we look into the history of our ancestors, right? Some that we don't even want to mention, right? It's like, really? Maybe we're even hoping to find, I don't know, some kind of long-forgotten investment that's been quietly building up a fortune that we can just stumble upon and claim, right? It was no different in Jesus's day. It was no different in Jesus's day. Genealogical lists were of great importance to the Jewish people. It gave them legitimacy. It gave them identity. And it established significance for the person. So Matthew, when he lists the ancestors of Christ, that is exactly what he's seeking to do. You see, in Matthew 1:1, it's showing that Jesus comes in the line of Abraham because all Jews can trace their lineage back to Abraham. Brothers and sisters, when we examine the genealogy that Matthew records, we see that he has grouped them in three groups of 14 generations. He has imposed a structure to the ancestors of Jesus, and even to fit within his scheme, he skips some generations that were actually under judgment from God. And he's not doing that to sanitize the genealogical tree, as we'll soon see in a moment. But we have to remember that when Matthew wrote, he was writing a gospel. He was writing the good news about Jesus, right? So he is writing for us the most important stuff that he is being given under guidance of the Holy Spirit. So let's look at this list of ancestors. The first group of 14 speaks of Jesus being of the son of Abraham. We know from the book of Genesis that Abraham was called by God and he was given the promise that he would be the father of all nations and that he would bring blessings to all nations. He was not just the father of the Jews, but he was also the father of the Gentiles. In Hebrews 11:8, we're reminded that Abraham was a man of faith who looked forward to the fulfillment of the promise made to him by God. That promise, brothers and sisters, that promise of blessing was to all nations, and it was fulfilled in Jesus Christ, because through faith, we're all descendants of Abraham. In Christ, Abraham's faith and hope found its fulfillment and found its definition. The second group of 14 speaks of Jesus being the son of David, who was held as Israel's greatest king. In fact, in the list which Matthew writes, only David is identified with the prefix king. Not Solomon, not any of the other ones, only David. In this group, Matthew wants us to understand that Jesus is from the line of David, the royal house of Israel, and therefore a king, but a much greater king than David was, who was considered at that point to be the greatest king in the history of Israel. In Jesus Christ, the promise made to David in 2 Samuel 7 that he would sit on an eternal kingdom was established, and it was brought to fulfillment in Jesus Christ. And the third group of 14 shows us that Jesus is the son of exile, that he's the son of exile. In verse 12 and in verse 17, we realize that Jesus is descended from those who were exiled from their homes and taken off into other countries, who were sent to Babylon, who were sent to Egypt. For those reading this genealogy for the first time, the bitter memories, the painful memories would have been evoked of their time in exile. And Jesus, our Savior, Emmanuel, God with us, is descended from those who know that suffering. He is descended from those who know the pain of being dispossessed. And Jesus would also know this in his own life also. Through all of this, Matthew wants us to understand that this is no ordinary family tree, but a sign of God at work throughout history, throughout generations and generations, to the very moment when this little baby was born in Bethlehem some 2,000 years ago. One of the things I think that often happens when you research your family is that skeletons can appear out of the woodwork, right? And Jesus really is no different. And Matthew lists for us some skeletons that, when you think about them in terms of being written 2,000 years ago, were pretty shocking that Matthew included, but he did include them. In this genealogy, Matthew did the rare and yet very interesting thing by including four women by name in the genealogy. In the genealogy of Matthew, we see listed Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, and Bathsheba. This is fascinating, really unheard of during this time. And there's a reason why Matthew did this, because all of these four women, just as King David prefigured Jesus, just as Abraham prefigured Jesus, these four women, in their own way, prefigure Mary, the virgin that gave birth to Jesus, Jesus's mother, in many ways. The story of Rahab is a fascinating one. Tamar, we read in Genesis chapter 38, is an Aramean, and she seduces her father-in-law. And she has to bear the scandal of becoming pregnant outside of marriage. And yet she was in Jesus' genealogy, listed right here. Rahab, we read in Joshua chapter 2, was a Canaanite woman. And not only a Canaanite woman, she was a prostitute. Prostitute who helped the spies when they were getting ready to conquer the promised land. And the words that she spoke to those spies were, according to your words, let it be so. Ruth was a Moabite, and she was an admirable daughter-in-law who in her journey to Bethlehem with Naomi was a model of faith because Ruth, a Moabite, put her trust in God, not knowing what her future entailed. And lastly, Bathsheba, or how she was listed as the wife of Uriah the Hittite, committed adultery with King David and gave birth to a son who would die because of the sin of another. So Bathsheba knew and understood the pain of losing a child. All of these women, brothers and sisters, had their shortcomings, and yet they all prefigured Mary, the mother of Jesus. Mary knew the scandal and shame of being pregnant outside of marriage, just like Tamar did. Mary said, according to your words, let it be done, when God spoke to her of the future plans that he had for her. The same words that Rahab had said to the spies as they were getting ready to enter the promised land. Mary made a physical journey of faith to Bethlehem, unsure of her future and no doubt frightened, just like Ruth did. And Mary would know the pain, the stabbing pain deep in the heart as she watched her son die for the sins of the world, as she watched her son die for you and for me, just like Bathsheba watched her son die. Each of these women point to an aspect of Mary's experience as the mother of Jesus. So brothers and sisters, when we take this genealogy as a whole, I believe that there is a lot that we can learn from it. The first thing that we can learn from it is we're here celebrating Christmas in 2023. The first thing that we can learn from it is that God surprises us and that he has come in Christ for both the Jew and the Gentile. So what does that mean in our language? It means that Jesus came for everybody. Every single person in this room, I'm telling you right now, and we're going to pray before the end of this, but if you're here for the first time, if you've never seen me, if you were just driving by and saw cars and wanted to stop by because you wanted to see what was going on, if you don't know Jesus, let me tell you something. Jesus knows you. And Jesus died for you. And he loves you very much. That's the first thing. The second thing is that God surprises us and that he comes for very unusual people. He comes for the fallen. He comes for the dispossessed. And he comes for the least and for the exiled among us. You know, when Jesus comes, he doesn't come for the LA Dodgers. He comes for the Bad News Bears. And then he turns them into the Dodgers. That's who Jesus is. He comes for the lowest. There's no one here that is outside, that is too good, that is too high, that is too low for Jesus' reach. The third thing that God surprises us with is he surprises us in that he works in and through history to fulfill his word and his purpose. And he does that through the most unlikely people, whether it's Tamar or Abraham or whoever it is, God works through the most unlikely people to bring about his will. And lastly, God surprises us in the fact that he comes to save sinners. And he doesn't save them through words He doesn't save them through money. He saves them through the blood of his son. He gave his son. He gave his son to take your place. That little baby that we all love, sweet little baby Jesus, came to die for you and came to die for me. Brothers and sisters, here's my prayer, and we're going to pray here and kind of wrap it up. My prayer is that we know, that we can understand that the surprise of Jesus' birth, even though we hear it every year, even though we see it every year, even though we sing about it every year, that it feels brand new and fresh this year, that the Holy Spirit is making it alive in your life to truly understand the immensity of the word Emmanuel, God with us. Every culture in the world claims to have a God somewhere. But you know what we Christians have? We have a God with us. We have a God that is alive, and we have a God that is with us. And we have a God that is for us. Emmanuel, God with us. God with you and me. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we're going to pray. We're going to pray. And as we pray, here's what I'm simply going to ask you, okay? Have you ever, on Christmas, have you ever gotten up, okay? And I got to experience this a little bit yesterday. We had cousin Christmas yesterday. And in our family, we have 7 nights of Christmas, okay? I don't even understand it. But last night, we had cousin Christmas, okay? My son Dale had a gift, a particular gift that he wanted, that he has wanted for months. And literally, we must have done a great job of keeping him in the dark. Because last night, his aunt gave it for him. And I'm so sad that I didn't have my phone to record his expression, because it was as if someone had just given him the greatest thing of all time. Right? It was one, the pure joy of him opening this gift was one of the most wonderful things as a parent that I've ever seen. Brothers and sisters, here's what I'm going to tell you. Every person in this room right now is a child of God, okay? And your heavenly Father is handing you a gift. It is the gift of his son. It is the gift of Jesus. It is the gift of forgiveness. It is the gift of salvation. And all he wants you to do is take it. And it is the most wonderful thing you could do. And there isn't a thing that puts a smile on the Father's face more than one of his children accepting that gift. So it's Christmas, brothers and sisters. The Lord's giving you a gift. I pray that as we pray, you take that gift. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. And Lord, as we're gathered here, celebrating the birthday of Jesus, Lord, we're going to pray. I pray that everyone follows along. So if you're there, pray quietly and pray along. Lord Jesus, I love you. As I'm here, Lord, I pray that you forgive me of my sins. I humbly turn my back on my sin, Lord, and want to follow you more. So, Lord, come be with me, Jesus. Come take my hand as I place my faith in you, for I believe in you, Jesus. I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you came to this earth, suffered and died and rose again for me, and that through my faith in you, Lord, I can have eternity with you. So, Jesus, be with me. Strengthen me. Fill me. Help me to follow you more closely. Jesus, thank you for giving me this gift on your birthday. We love you, Jesus. Stay near us always. And we ask for this in your precious name. Amen.
just can stand. I'm sorry.
Father, oh, and before we pray, I have a gift for all of you. We don't have to tear down this evening, so if you'd like to help us tear down on Tuesday, come on out. But let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your gift, and let us leave this place, Lord, celebrating every day the reality that the one who loves us more than anything in the world, our Creator, came to this world to save us. Jesus, we love you. Be with us always. We ask for this in your name. Amen. Merry Christmas, everybody.